First cause, the first cause is infective cause. The next cause is hematological cause. The third one is hepatological cause. Next comes the metabolic causes for hepatosplenomegaly. Followed by that, it's the miscellaneous causes. Got it? So the infective causes for hepatosplenomegaly is again reclassified into three: the viral causes, the bacterial causes, and the parasitic causes. Okay, what are all the viral causes for hepatosplenomegaly? So the viral causes for hepatosplenomegaly are going to be cytomegalovirus, hepatitis virus, toxoplasmosis, and these three viruses you first remember, that's more than enough. The bacterial causes for hepatosplenomegaly are Salmonella, Shigella, Vibrio, Mycobacterium tuberculosis. In rickettsial infections, scrub typhus is going to contribute to hepatosplenomegaly. Okay, and followed by that, the parasitic causes for hepatosplenomegaly is going to be malaria, Kalaza, Leishmania, Ronawani, and Echinococcus granulosis. Echinococcus granulosis is is the organism which is going to cause this hydatid cyst. Then come to the hematological causes for hepatosplenomegaly. The hematological causes is again reclassified into RBC cause, WBC cause, and platelet cause. Okay. The RBC cause for hepatosplenomegaly is going to be one and only hemolytic anemia. And the WBC cause for hepatosplenomegaly is leukemia. And the platelet cause for hepatosplenomegaly is idiopathic thrombocytopenic purpura, and most of the time it's going to be the chronic ITP. Got it? Then come to the hepatological causes for hepatosplenomegaly. First of all, before that, you guys need to know about the bilirubin metabolism. The bilirubin metabolism is the hemoglobin is converted into heme and globin. The globin is converted into biliverdin and then the bilirubin. Bilirubin is going to enter the liver through the help of UDP glucuronidase transferase enzyme and gets conjugated with the UDP glucuronic acid to form into a conjugated bilirubin and then gets excreted through the bile duct. Got it? So the ones that is getting excreted through the bile duct, it's going to get excreted through the urine and the feces as urobilinogen and stercobilinogen. So based on that, the hepatological causes for hepatosplenomegaly is classified again into prehepatic cause, hepatic cause, and posthepatic cause. So the prehepatic cause for hepatosplenomegaly is going to be hemolytic anemia. Hepatological causes for hepatosplenomegaly is going to be hepatitis, portal triaditis, liver cirrhosis, and all these things. But liver cirrhosis is very uncommon in kids. Biliary cirrhosis and neonatal cholestasis, which is going to be converted into cirrhosis, that's a rare phenomenon. Okay, and other than that, post-hepatic causes for hepatosplenomegaly is nothing but obstructive jaundice. Got it? Come to the metabolic causes. Metabolic causes for hepatosplenomegaly is going to be G6PD, Gilbert, Dubin-Johnson, Rotar, Crigler-Najjar, and all these things. And the miscellaneous causes, any type of CA, where the metastasis is going to go to the liver or the spleen, is going to cause hepatosplenomegaly, Hodgkin's lymphoma, and other than that, all other causes which is not going to get categorized under infective, hematological, hepatological, or metabolic is going to come under miscellaneous. Okay? Yeah. Let's move on. So, first of all, while categorizing all these things, we need to know the history of what and all is going to be there for each and everything. So, basically, for an infective etiology, there is definitely going to be a fever. Okay, so fever means if it's going to be a viral infection, it's going to be a fever for not more than 1 week. Bacterial infection, not more than 2 weeks. And parasitic, it's going to be more than 2 weeks. The fever is going to be more than 2 weeks. So based on that, we can categorize it under whatever infection it's going to be there. So come to the hematology causes. If it's going to be a hemolytic anemia, RBC cause, so what and all history is going to be there for the patient? It's either going to be lethargy, tiredness, weakness, and all these things under hemolytic anemia causes. Leukemia causes, it's going to be bone tenderness, bone pain, chronic fever for more than 2 months, and all these things. Platelet causes for hepatosplenomegaly, that is for ITP. Most of the time, it's going to be rashes all over the body, and other than that, the bleeding manifestations. Come to the hepatological causes. The prehepatic, that is the hemolytic causes, we have already spoken over here. Then the hepatological causes, that is hepatitis and all, we have already spoken in the viral infection. So the hepatitis virus A, B, C, D, E, and all these things is going to contribute to the hepatitis. Post-hepatic causes, you are going to have pale colored stools and high colored urine. That is the obstructive jaundice. So metabolic causes, everything, most of the things are going to manifest under the age of 6 months. So most of the things are congenital. So it's going to manifest under the age of 6 months. And miscellaneous causes, it's completely random. Okay. Let's go on to the slides. Okay. First of all, you guys need to know the normal palpability of the liver. Okay. Can you hear me, ma'am?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I can hear you.
Okay, okay, normal palpability of the liver. So for an adult, the normal palpability of the liver shouldn't be palpable below the right costal margin. For the pediatric age group, remember this thing, 0 to 4 years, 4 to 12 years, and more than 12 years. So 0 to 4 years, 2 centimeter liver palpability is normal. Up till 12 years, from 4 years to 12 years, it's 1 centimeter palpability. And more than 12 years, the liver shouldn't be palpable at all. Okay, the liver span is an important index determined by percussion. Upper border of the liver percussed at 5th intercostal space in the midclavicular line, 7th intercostal space in the mid-axillary line, and 9th intercostal space in scapular line. So normal liver span at birth, it's going to be 6 centimeters. At 2 months of age, it's 5 centimeters. 1 year, 1 to 2 years, it's 6 centimeters. 3 years, it's 6.5. Just take a screenshot of this. 4 year, it is 7 centimeters. 5 years, it's 8 centimeters. And 12th year, it's 9 centimeters. Okay. Okay. Consistency of the liver. Based on the consistency of the liver, also, we will be able to make a diagnosis of whether it's a chronic infection or an acute infection. If it's going to be a firm liver, it's most of the time going to be a chronic infection. If it's going to be a soft, non-tender liver, it's going to be an acute infection kind of thing. Okay. So firm liver can be seen in TB or cirrhosis. Hard liver can be seen in malignancy. Nodular liver can be seen in cirrhosis, neoplasm, and even echinococcus granulosis. Now, just know that one also. Tender liver is going to be seen in dengue, CCF, and amoebic liver abscess, and all those things. And rubbery liver is going to be seen in trauma. Okay. Viscerotosis. Okay. Ptosis of liver. What is viscerotosis? Viscerotosis is the weakening of the muscle which is holding the liver, and so the liver is going to be prolapsed. Got it? So it can happen in rickets where the ligament laxity is there, and subdiaphragmatic abscess, empyema, emphysema, pneumothorax, and all these things. So diaphragm is the one which is holding the liver below the right costal margin. If there is going to be a weakness in the diaphragm, so the liver is going to just be pushed into the right thoracic space. That is only called as ptosis of liver. Okay. Only hepatomegaly with minimal splenomegaly. What and all conditions will be there? So as we have already spoken about this previously, infections like viral hepatitis, HIV, dengue, typhoid, leptospirosis, tuberculosis, amebiasis. In this PPT, it has been wrote completely random. So categorize it like viral, bacterial, or parasitic. That's in that way you'll be able to remember it easily. Congestive cardiac failure can also cause hepatomegaly, which I haven't spoken about in that classification. It's going to come under the miscellaneous group. Infiltrative, that is the nutritional, like fatty infiltration in the liver, like glycogen storage diseases, malignancy, that we have spoken in the metabolic causes. Cirrhosis, early congenital hepatic fibrosis, that can also contribute to hepatomegaly. And the miscellaneous causes, Bucciari syndrome, hydatid cyst, and all these things. Splenomegaly, spleen may be normally palpable in 30% of the newborn and 50% of the infants. And after 1 year of age, if the spleen is going to be palpable, that means the spleen is 2.5 times bigger than its normal size. So when you palpate a spleen for a kid above 1 year of age, the spleen, it is called as a splenomegaly. Got it? So we cannot come in splenomegaly for a newborn or the infant when the liver, when the spleen is palpable. Okay? The causes for splenomegaly are infectious causes, viral, bacterial, and protozoal. Just recollect the flowchart which I have shown you. The hematological causes, the RBC cause, the WBC cause, and the platelet cause. The portal hypertension, which is going to go in for cirrhosis or EHPO, extrahepatic portal venous obstruction. And infiltrative causes is Hodgkin's and non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, the connective tissue disorder, storage disorder, and the miscellaneous. The same way where I have shown you in that flowchart, just remember that one. In the end of the PPT, I will I'll show you the flowchart again. Okay. Massive splenomegaly is going to be there in tropical splenomegaly, chronic myeloid leukemia, storage disorder, Kala-Azar, myeloproliferative disorders, and hemolytic anemia is going to be a chronic hemolytic anemia like thalassemia, hereditary spherocytosis, where they require multiple blood transfusions. They can have a massive splenomegaly. Okay. In cases of hepatosplenomegaly infection, fever is going to be there. So infective causes for hepatosplenomegaly, there is going to be a fever. It's either going to be acute or chronic, and the causes are viral, bacterial, and parasitic alone. Okay. Hematological causes for hepatosplenomegaly, the reasons are going to the symptoms are going to be pallor, bleeding manifestations, lymphadenopathy, fever, mild jaundice, recent blood transfusions, failure to thrive, and age of onset. Congestive HSM is going to be there in cirrhosis with the pulmonary hypertension, caput medulla, ascites, gynecomastia, testicular atrophy, palmar erythema, spider nevi, and vitamin deficiency, ADEK. First of all these points are because of acute liver, are signs of acute liver cell failure. Okay, so if there is going to be a question of what are all the signs of acute liver cell failure, you just mentioned these points. This is more than enough. Infiltrative disease like Hodgkin's and non-Hodgkin's lymphoma is going to be for a very longer time, more than 2 months fever, 3 months fever, not able to gain weight, appropriate for the age, and all these things. Okay, how to make a diagnosis? Always categorize it, like however I told you in the flowchart. When you are going to categorize it and note down the history, you can easily make a diagnosis for hepatosplenomegaly. Hepatosplenomegaly is the most easiest case you will be getting for the pediatric clinical exam. When you're getting the hepatosplenomegaly, kindly do not hesitate to take a case. Okay. So inborn errors of metabolism, these cases and all won't be kept for you in the exam. Just know what are all the inborn errors of metabolism which is going to cause an HSM, like phenylketonuria, tyrosinemia, amino acid ureas, and all those things. Okay, fine. And let's go back to the flowchart again. Okay. So, one final revision. What are the causes of HSM? It's infective, hematological, hepatological, metabolic, and miscellaneous. So infective causes is going to be classified into again like viral, bacterial and parasitic. So the viral causes for hepatosplenomegaly are dengue, hepatitis, cytomegalovirus, toxoplasmosis and all those things. Herpes, everything is going to contribute to hepatomegaly. Bacterial causes for hepatomegaly is going to be Salmonella, Shigella, Vibrio, Mycobacterium tuberculosis, scrub typhus. And the parasitic causes for HSM is going to be malaria, Kalazar, Echinococcus granulosis. These three things you remember, that's enough. Then hematological causes for HSM is going to be again classified into like RBC cause, WBC cause, and the platelet cause. RBC cause is hemolytic anemia, WBC cause is leukemia, and the platelet cause is chronic ITP. The hepatological causes for HSM is based on the bilirubin metabolism. The bilirubin metabolism, we already spoken about that. So how hemoglobin is converted into bilirubin and bilirubin, where it's getting conjugated in the liver and getting excreted via urine and stools. So it's classified like pre-hepatic, hepatic, and post-hepatic causes. The pre-hepatic causes is going to be hemolytic jaundice, as we have already spoken about that. Hepatic causes is going to be hepatitis. We have spoken about that in viral causes. And the post-hepatic causes is obstructive jaundice. Obstructive jaundice or any neonatal cholestasis, which is going to go in for hepatosplenomegaly. Okay. Then come to the metabolic causes, which is going to manifest at the age less than 6 months of age. So the causes are going to be G6PD, Gilbert's, Dubin-Johnson, Rota, Crigler-Najjar. Whatever metabolic causes you know, you can get, you can write it over here, like Wilson's, where copper deposition will be there, hemosiderosis, hemochromatosis, the liver, and all these things will be coming over here. And the miscellaneous causes are CA and Hodgkin's, non-Hodgkin's. That's it. So draw the flowchart, get the history, categorize for hepatosplenomegaly. It's an easy go-through for the exam. Okay? That's it, ma.
Okay, sir.
Anything you guys want to know extra?
Any students want, you can text it in the chat box for sir.
Which is it? What?
Sir, I asked the students if they have any questions or any additions, they can
Okay.
add it in the chat box.
Okay.
Hello, hello, sir.
Yeah, tell me ma.
Hello sir, in hematological conditions where we have any leukemia like in childhood cases,
Okay.
usually is both hepato and splenomegaly simultaneously seen or is there any specific conditions where uniquely
Yeah,
we have
okay,
only
no.
hepatomegaly?
So whatever I told you over here, most of the conditions are going to be hepatosplenomegaly than the splenohepatomegaly. So whenever there is going to be a chronic hepatomegaly, it's going to go in for splenomegaly also, because the splenic vein is going to get go to the portal vein. So any hepatomegaly is going to obstruct the portal vein, which is going to cause a splenomegaly. Understood? So splenomegaly causes and splenohepatomegaly causes are whatever I showed you in the slide. Tropical splenomegaly, chronic hemolytic anemia, where the spleen is going to be massive. You remember those things, whichever I showed you on the slide? Those are the things alone. Okay. You want me to show it again?
Yes, sir, if possible. Thank you, sir. No problem.
Yeah. Okay. Can you hear me, ma?
Yes, sir, it's clear, sir.
Okay. So the specifically for splenomegaly, where the spleen is bigger than the liver, that is only called as the splenohepatomegaly. The causes of those things are I have written over here.
Yeah, sir.
Got it?
Sure. Yes, sir.
Okay. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So, why is there hepatomegaly in these cases of splenomegaly?
Why is there hepatomegaly in cases of why is there splenomegaly in cases of hepatomegaly? That's the question, I think. Because the splenic vein, yeah, that can be isolated splenomegaly. Okay. Ask.
No, sir, when you say splenohepatomegaly, does it mean that the spleen enlargement is also causing hepatomegaly?
No. Splenohepatomegaly, whenever I say that, the spleen is bigger than the liver, that's it. The spleen enlargement is definitely not going to contribute to the liver enlargement, but the liver enlargement is going to contribute to the spleen enlargement. Understood? Because the artery, yeah, which is draining from the spleen is getting inside the portal vein through the inside the liver. Understood? Or did I confuse you?
No, sir. Understood, sir.
Yeah. Okay. Splenomegaly can be isolated. Isolated hepatomegaly can also be there, but the size of the liver is going to be smaller. So, chronic case of hepatomegaly is definitely going to be having a splenomegaly also.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Yeah. When is the class going to start for you, Ma? Like clinical classes and all?
We don't know yet, sir. We haven't got information on reopening of colleges. So we are waiting for them to announce it and we will come back to college.
Okay. So when you're going to come to the clinical class, it will be much easier for us also to teach with the case in front of us. Fine.